This week, episode 303 of Stogie Geeks, Drew and myself interview Tim Wong of Pier 28 Premium Cigars. Can't wait to hear about this brand. Super excited about this brand. Also, in our second segment, we're going to talk more about our JC Newman promo that we have coming up. And Drew and myself go through some sticks of the week. It all starts right here on episode 303 of Stogie Geeks.
This is a Security Weekly production. Broadcasting live from G-Unit Studios in Rhode Island, it's the show where cigars burn slow, ashes fall fast, and cocktails flow steady. It's the Stogie Geek Show.
Welcome, everyone, to the Stogie Geek Show. Joe and I are already silly.
Oh, yeah.
Joe Hozempa, a.k.a. Joe Hollywood, is here with me in studio.
I'm fired up.
Havana Cigar Club, located in Warwick, Rhode Island, is a great place to enjoy a drink and a cigar. Stogie Geeks listeners can find a $5 off coupon on our website by clicking the HCC logo.
Confidence. Confidence isn't walking into a room with your nose in the air, thinking you're better than anyone else. It's walking into a room and not having to compare yourself to anyone in the first place.
Welcome to Stogie Geeks episode 303. It's in the cybersecurity world, it's post-Vegas. In the cigar world, it's really post-Vegas. However, in any world that you're in, it's really always post-Vegas because Vegas is always Vegas. We're going to talk to you, the Stogie Geeks listeners. I'm letting you in on some inside baseball. There might be a cameo appearance by Mr. Paul Azadorian in the next couple of episodes. I had the opportunity to go to Casa Fluente out there. That's great work if you can find it. And we also went to the Davidoff Lounge over there on the Strip in Vegas. That's also great work if you can find it. I might take some time to talk to Drew about some of that stuff later on in the episode. But right now we have Drew via Skype out in Texas. Drew, how's it going, sir?
Good morning or good afternoon, everybody. Yeah. Everything here is nice and hot. It's been like that for the last week and a half, and it's going to continue being nice and hot. 100 plus degree weather, but we're here surviving.
You're out there in Texas, right?
Yes.
Everything's big
Bedford,
in Texas.
Bedford, Texas.
Everything's big in Texas. The beers are big. The belt buckles are big. Country music's big.
Oh, yeah.
And you guys like your big cigars out there, too. So we're going to get to Sticks of the Week there. But before that, you and I have the opportunity to introduce Tim Wong of Pier 28 Premium Cigars to talk Pier 28 cigars. Tim, welcome to Story Geeks. How are you?
Good morning, gentlemen from California. I appreciate you having me on, and I'm happy to talk with cigars with you. I'm excited to be on the show today.
Awesome. Both of you guys and hitting me up in the morning, right? It's crazy. Right,
because you're having your nice beverage. My beverage is still a little black coffee. We'll wait for a little later.
Yeah.
We'll make it Irish a little later this morning.
Sure. So. I had my coffee in the morning and my cigar on the golf course this morning. I'm not going to lie. It was a good time. Golf pretty good. Got three pars, some bogeys and some double bogeys. Nothing over doubles, so that's kind of cool.
No snowman, it's a good day.
No snowman, and I only put one in the water, took one penalty. Spent a lot of time at the beach, but I was able to get out. It was really weird, you know.
Right.
But the golf course that we were at, the pin placement, you could tell this time of the year here in the Northeast from all the league tournament play, which usually lasts till like the kids go to school and stuff like that, the pin placement was just horrendous. Like it was like in the worst possible spots. And I think they were doing that just because of the leagues, because that's usually seems to be the case there. But nevertheless, We should do a golf show. I would like to do that as well someday.
If they put the pin, the cup in the center of the green every time, what's the challenge in that?
Well, you can still get in trouble. You can still get in trouble. There's plenty, there's plenty of water and sand to find yourself around.
I've spent a lot of time on the beach and in the water. I understand completely.
Yeah. It's a good time, but it was good to catch up with some friends and a former coworker of mine. From previous employment, so it was kind of cool. We had a foursome together, and you could tell we're getting old because normally on a Friday we would probably call in sick or something like that, and we're like, okay, we all shook hands, gave hugs, and said, and we got to go to work. Yeah. But lucky for me, I get to go to work and do Stogie Geeks. They got to go to work. You know what I mean?
Well, I understand completely. Yesterday, I was in Palm Springs visiting an account, hoping to a new cigar lounge in a casino. So I was there helping them train the staff on how to sell a particular line of cigars. And it's like, I'm in a casino. I didn't gamble. I didn't do anything. I just went for training and smoked cigars. It's like, I'm getting old, right? There's no, usually Vegas, whatever, maybe any casino, you rip it up. Nah. Just finished my training, took a good night's sleep and headed back home. It's more sales call.
Right. It's like, kind of like life gets in the way, What are you going to do?
Exactly.
It's the way it goes. So, Tim, you own Pier 28 Cigars.
I do. Absolutely.
You started this, I believe, 2016. Is that correct?
The company was founded 2015. It took a year to get the first line to the marketplace. So the first actual release, actually I'm holding one, is the Habano. Mm-hmm. And that was launched 2016, hit the marketplace in 2016.
Awesome.
And then subsequently, every year I've launched one new line. So after the Habano came the Maduro. Last year was the Oscuro, and then coming up probably in the mid to late September timeframe, I've got a Connecticut company. So four different blends at this point. I try and keep it simple because I'm still a small company. So it's one line a year, one new blend a year.
Mm-hmm. Do you have, you want to keep going with that, with that cadence and release a couple more? Or,
like I say, it's an interesting place. I mean, I'm not going to try and get too political, but a lot of it depends on what the FDA is going to decide to do. When we started this, people thought it was a little crazy launching a new line, with FDA looming, but there were things that we could do, being part of Espinosa Cigars. I don't know if your listeners or your viewers, know that I'm part of that company as well. And so my cigars are made in Lozona, in Esteli, Nicaragua. We announced four lines initially, and, I believe I have, be able to draw that substantive, equivalency for those lines. From this point forward now, if I do more lines, it'll be interesting to see where it goes. But, if the FDA lets us keep, keep the testing reasonable, however it decides, not the way it's currently written, I'll be able to continue to produce cigars, because I have a little bit of history and we've done the proper things to keep it on the marketplace, with a reasonable amount of, regulation versus, not knowing at all. So, I feel like I'm in a good place. We'll find out. As soon as they begin to actually enforce the regulations, how companies like mine will get treated. But I'm fairly confident that what I have on the marketplace will be able to continue, and whether or not I'll be able to launch more product after this will be, that'll be to TBD to see if we can, keep it on the marketplace as well. Yeah. Obviously, you can keep launching stuff until the enforcement date, and then, try and figure out what they're going to ask you, if it's reasonable or not. But, at least I think I'll be able to keep stuff on the marketplace, even if FDA decides to give us the Armageddon scenario.
Yeah, I believe you'll be fine. Track record, I got to find this audio clip. I've been saying this for years now. In May of 2015, when I was back, this is pre-Stogie Geeks, I was doing Cigar Club Radio, and... Mm-hmm. I had interviewed some of my sponsors and all that stuff, and I said in May of 2015, it's going to be 2020 before we even know what the hell the direction the FDA is going in. And all of my guests on there had said, no, it's really coming down. Even if you go back on previous episodes of Story Geek, some people says, no, it's going down. And there's really no pivot point. And not to turn into political, but there really is bigger problems or topics that the Hill has to solve besides premium tobacco, right? And so, I do believe that most states and federal level are looking at numbers and seeing where they can get additional sources of income. Mm-hmm. And I did say it back then that it certainly sounds like a money grab, for sure. But again, our big government has always took a stance, quote unquote, of anti-tobacco, yet, mm-hmm. you know, the cigarette boom, and then it went down, and then now you have this unicorn piss that I dub it, or vape, right? For you new Stogie Geeks listeners, you know that you know there's a big vape academic going on, and there's big and government has to kind of keep the masses kind of satisfied, I guess. But realistically speaking, like, I don't see it just coming down and being that cut and dry. It's gonna be like a rollout series. But, sure. You know,
the greatest fear for us, and I think you've heard this many times from other manufacturers and other people you've had on, is that, you know, to this day, the fundamental problem we have in sort of defending who we are as an industry is making, you know, the big government, as you say, understand what we are. You know, it's just much easier to roll us in with the dreaded vapes and the dreaded cigarettes. And that's always the fear. I mean, this is what I think TCA and you know, CRA and all those groups are fighting primarily, not just the regulation, but also making them understand who we are, because we do need to be treated differently. We're a different product, and that's the hardest thing. That's always been the hardest thing for us.
Yeah. Little inside baseball, my first professional job was mm-hmm. with a senator here. I'm sorry, it was a House of Representatives at the Washington level here, Jack Reed, mm-hmm. when he was House of Representatives. And then Senator Claiborne Pell had retired. Jack Reed had went up to Senate. He's still currently in the Senate there. And having worked there, right, this is what drives me crazy about, like, Cigar Rights America, right? Here we go, right? This is why I need a bodyguard if I go to freaking IBCPR, right? This is what drives me. No, because everybody's like, oh, you know, you got to call your senator. You got to tweet Donald Trump. You got to No. You need to get to the chief of staff of that person. Because I've legitimately worked in there, and this chief of staff the chief of staff rolls up in front of politician a whoever, right, guy or girl, doesn't matter, and says, "This is your agenda today, and these are your talking points." Bam, and they have aides, because I was a congressional aide, is how mm-hmm. I started, and they have aides that give you the points of what they need as based upon research, and we've done that. And if you could get into, you know, I know Marco Rubio is senator from Florida is taking a huge public stance against that and whatnot. Guarantee you, his chief of staff is really on that and saying, okay, like let's just gently apply the brakes here, because sometimes administration wise, right, whether you like current president or not going there, right, but whether you like them or not. There's now going to be a poise now, because we're going to get ready for the year before the election, right? There's going to be a poise. So guess what? It is not going to be decided under Trump administration one or right. potential Trump administration two or whoever goes on that side. It's going to be the next one, which if you're in a time machine, right? Now we're talking 2021, maybe at best, or 2022, especially because historically speaking, if it's a new president, right, it takes a year for them to get up to speed as to what's going on. And oh, by the way, they're not going to come in and say, that's it, I'm taking out big tobacco. They're not. They got so many. I mean, all you got to do is just pick a news station, and there's so many listings that go up there. So I guess that's the extent of my political rant. I think we'll be safe there. For sure. But I do want to hear more about Pier28 cigars. I could go on forever about, like, the FDA, because there are certain things that, from my experience, and what I like here in Rhode Island is there was, like, an abandoned Air Force base called Quonset Point. Mm-hmm. The National Guard was there. And I remember back in 1996 when I was working for him, they were talking about making it like one of two things, right? They were talking about making it a port for cruise ships, and having it be like a port for cruise ships, so that everyone in the Northeast doesn't have to go to New York or Miami anymore. They can all do that and get the duty tax and all that thing that there. That got shut down, and they made it an industrial park, and it does employ a lot of people. So it's like, and then you look at from when that came to fruition from 96, it's still being built and has room to grow. And here we are 25 years later. So, you know, and that's just one experience that I happen to work on. And that was like people's jobs, people's livelihood, big tech, quote unquote, coming into Rhode Island and doing all of that stuff. It's going to be an awfully long time till we know which direction, unless they pull the trigger and lump us in. But I really don't think that they will. I don't.
And I hope you're correct. That's a very, you know, a positive view of the whole situation. Obviously, you know, a lot of guys are all over the map, right? There's some guys are doomsday. Some guys are blue sky. So, you know, I like to think I'm in the middle somewhere. I think regulation is reality. Eventually, we're going to have to put something through. Question is, can we shape it and live with it? And I think that's the best case scenario for us. And then hopefully that's what we get. I'd love to get your scenario where it just keeps going and going until somebody goes, this is just terrible, and blows it up. I hope that's the case. But, you know, the FDA didn't put together a 500-page document for you know, hoping that it was going to, you know, not pass or not be executed. So we'll see. Like you said, I'd love it if you're right. If you give me 6-7 years ago, do things, that's great. Stay out of our way for 6 or 7 years
while we
figure it out. Right. I'll take that every day of the week.
Yeah. Sure, absolutely. So in my opinion, cigar aficionados or cigar enthusiasts or whatever level you are always goes through a point of one of two things. Number one, I want to own my own cigar shop, right? Mm-hmm. Or number two, the coup de grace, I think, I want to roll out my own brand. Yeah. Right.
Yeah,
so
absolutely.
So you obviously rolled out your own brand. So now all you got to do is just start a cigar shop and then you're going to be all set. But however, take us through that process on how you started, the barrier to entry, kind of some of the hurdles, the story. Take us through that.
I love it. Well, first of all, I just want you to know that the cigar store is my retirement gig. I expect to be about 82 years old, using my walker, yelling at guys, going, "You gotta smoke that piece of no."
You know,
that's the retirement gig. So.
Right.
But I think you described my story, the path at least, very well. I started in the cigar business about 16 years ago. I've been blessed to work with a lot of great families. I've been a sales rep pretty much, well, not pretty much, but all of my time here. Based out of the West Coast, I've worked for, I started with Toraño Cigars way back in 2004. I've worked for Padilla, I've worked for Rocky Patel, General Cigar, Espinosa as well. So I've, you know, it's, my journey has been great because I've been able to learn from small, medium, large companies, you know, and as I progress in this industry, it's exactly what you say. It's like, you know what? I was a cigar geek, a stogie geek before I got into the business. I got lucky and met the right people. That's how I ended up being able to be a sales rep. But, you know, I loved everything about it. I would, you know, read what I could. I loved learning about the farming, the agronomy, the factories, the whole nine yards. Just anything I could find on cigars, I kind of absorbed. And then it just kind of grew. It's like, you know what? I would love it. And I smoke, you know, a lot of cigar companies call me the rep that hurts the profit margins the most because I smoke a lot of cigars every day, 6 to 10 cigars. And that's just how it's just built. It's like, you know what? I would love to go play with some tobacco. The romance of the industry, if you kind of fall in love with it, you know, I would love to try my hand. It's the same probably with every, you know, craft beer maker, every small winery. You know, you get a bug, you get a, you know, you hear the word thrown out, passion thrown out a lot. And it is true. You know,
it is.
More than just smoking the product, I wanted to be part of this industry in a greater fashion than just selling cigars. And so, you know, I took my time with it. I didn't, you know, just, you know, some guys, you know, the way the industry works sometimes, you go down to Nicaragua, you go down to Estoril, you can start a cigar brand overnight. You know, if you've got a few dollars to do that. The cigar is the easiest thing to make. It's everything else that is more difficult. So, you know, I bided my time. I learned, like I said, I learned a lot from a lot of different companies, small, medium, and large. And that was going to be one of my philosophies when I started my line, was that I was going to take best practices from everybody that I learned from. So you fast forward a little bit, and, you know, I've known Eric Espinosa for a long time. Him and I actually both, his career and his journey in this business is very, you know, I have a similar path with him. He started out in retail. He's done, you know, he was a on the road rep for many, many years working for Drew Estate and Rocky. He launched 601 many years ago with his partner, Eddie Ortega, you know, in the first iteration of the company. So, you know, as we talked a lot and he said, you know, I know what you want to do. when he started Espinosa and launched Lozona 7 or 8 years ago, he goes, you know, give me another year or two. I was working for General Cigar at the time. I know what you want to do. And, you know, you'll come down to the factory. You'll love what I'm trying to do. And we'll partner up. You and I work together. And he was prophetic with that. You know, I just, when he's like, you know, he approached me a couple of years later, you know, come down to Miami, come down to the factory, see what we're doing. That's when I met the rest of the crew over there. Hector Alfonso, he's the master blender, you know, Anthony, his son, Eric Jr. And they've always treated me like family. And they said, look, you know, we're doing great things over here in this factory. You know, come play, come see if you can put something together and work with us. And, you know, we'll figure out a way to support each other. And we have. So that's how I was, you know, I was born. I started working for Eric in 2014 as their West Coast rep. And then, you know, we started to put Pier 28 together in parallel with that. So now, you know, I work with them and for them at the same time. I sell, you know, his stuff here on the West Coast. I'm still on the road rep, which gives me a little bit of advantage selling my stuff.
Yeah.
The owner is the rep. It's a great way to work. And then we've just been very, very meticulous in building it slowly but surely. You know, I take a different route than the guys because it is my primary business, but it's also secondary to the things I do. Now I'm an independent broker. I represent a few other lines as well. So, you know, it gives me the opportunity to kind of get it into the portfolio and sell my stuff, but also sell other things at the same time. So, you know, it's a labor of love for me. You know, you start it, you know, as a little bit of a side project, I guess is the best way to say it. Mm-hmm. But now it's become, you know, 50-50 with everything I do. So I spend time doing Pier 28. I spend time working with my other manufacturers as well.
That's a great story, and it tells me that you're in the right spot, right? Because when we on in our other jobs that we do on a day-to-day basis here, we interview a bunch of security companies and have a security network, and you know, having multiple layers of I don't want to say income, but outputs where you're producing mm-hmm. your product for different spots really positions you. And one of the fascinating stats that I've come across is that like 50 by the year 2022, 57% of the workforce, this is not in just cybersecurity, this is like the general blanket there, 57% of the workforce is going to be a gig economy as right. opposed to I now go to one job, work there for 30, 40, 50 years, get a pension and do that. I believe police, firefighters, and state jobs are like the only ones left who really have that old model, right? And so, you know, it gives you a chance to not only explore new avenues as a broker with other companies. There might be a new cigar company that comes in town or comes on the market that you might want to wrap yourself around where you think that there's opportunity. And I think that's a very, very smart business move. Because it allows you to follow your dream, but it also allows you to bide time because some people want to follow their dreams and they run out of time or they run out of runway room or they don't have the capital or whichever.
And it's like I said, you mentioned, it's a very, very good situation for me. You know, the infrastructure that Espinosa has allows me to not have to build something immediately if the brand sticks. And obviously, we roll it out later as his own independent brand. Yeah, I'll build my own web, but you know, the fact that he's got a place to help warehouse it, to ship it, the fact that his reps are helping me get the word out on the cigar, you know, and treating it as he's always one of his own brands is fantastic. Just so you know, I also broker Illusion. I also broker AJ Fernández. And so I have friends on both sides. I was on earlier representing AJ. So to have those people as sounding boards, as people who smoke, just to give me opinions on what I'm doing and to be able to ask them questions and how would they handle situations, you know, helps me immensely. So, you know, I've got three of the best companies in the world, you know, backing me. And I'm also doing, you know, a little bit with the Regis and Nagis at Black Label. So now I'm also going to be able to kind of work, you know, with the True Boutique. So again, yeah. I guess this coalition essentially of people who are working with me and helping me that just, you know, it makes me feel good and knows that I'll be able to get, you know, as much information and as many opinions that can help me as possible.
Yep. I have one personal question because the way that you're positioned, it sounds like, because like if I were to work for you, Mm-hmm. I am love Espinosa. Love Comfortably Numb. Love the 601 La Bamba. La Bamba, right? Love those sticks. Can't wait to get my hands on your sticks. They're not relevant here in the Northeast. I do know that Drew has some comments, and he's coming up. He has had some, so I can't wait to hear about that. But it's
I'm working on it slowly but surely.
It sounds like Black Label. That's my wheelhouse, like for sure, right? Illusion. That's my wheel. Like if you listen to Story, it sounds like you get to represent what you smoke and what you like, because labels are like all over the map. If you look at it from a singularity cigar consumer purchase, yeah.
The thread that ties them all together is that I have a very much a Nicaraguan palate, and I'm unabashed about that. You know, I don't smoke that many Dominican-based cigars as much as you know. So I mean, Espinosa, Elysion, AJ, all those were companies that I enjoyed the cigars even when I wasn't working for them.
Yep.
So it was kind of it was nice and natural to kind of fit in and get those brands. And the same with Regis and the same with Black Label. They're on the small side. But again, all that stuff has that kind of Nicaraguan profile and construction and things like that appeal to me, make it easy for me to sell because I know what they're doing and, you know, comes into play in with the similarities with other companies. It makes it easy to sell that product, that portfolio of product. And, you know, my cigars fit right in there with everything else. So. Yeah. You know, it, you're right. I mean, when it came together this year, because this is a new development for me. It started about March when I joined a brokerage out of Arizona called Trendsetters. You know, this portfolio just sort of came together, and it's like, yeah. I mean, it fits. You know, like it's a great book of brands. I mean, it's almost to me at least the perfect book. You know?
Yeah, it really actually is, because if you take all of those brands and put them on a facings in the shop, they would be one of the foundations of you have something for the experience palette with, in my opinion, Black Label, Illusion, you know what I mean? You have entry level with AJ and then all the way up to the experience with AJ. Espinosa, same thing. You have entry level palettes all the way up to experience palettes, a variety of full body, medium, light stuff as well. So that's
well, and then there is something for every cigar smoker in that portfolio, right? If you're looking for that kind of that intro, that brand that you recognize, you've got AJ, you've got Espinosa. If you're looking for that true boutique, you've got Regis, you've got Black Label. Stuff that's interesting. And then of course Illusion is kind of best of both worlds, right? The new guy who finds it can smoke it, or the guys who smoke for 30 years can find it, and they all of it, you know, they realize that there's something, you know, just really unique and interesting about that brand. So and I'm hoping that my brand grows into those molds. You know, those are very good goals for me to have.
And one more comment, and then Drew's going to ask you a couple of questions, but because I always like try to hog the space. I don't know. I try not to, right? I totally try not to, but where I was going with this is like those brands, like the Espinosa, the Black Label, Illusion, they have a bit of a fanboy following. But it's not as fanatical as some of the other brands that are out there designing crazy stuff and all of that. You know what I mean? Like you know, like Black Label. Like I remember, Black Label sticks out to me on Story Geeks because I remember at the end of 2017, I did a top five companies to look out for here on Story Geeks, and two of the five were Espinosa and Black Label. Now, Black Label was my number one choice. Espinosa was a little bit lower on my totem pole. But like looking forward to things coming out, like when Black Label makes some stuff, I mean, the caps on like the Green Hornet, and help me through the other one. There's a blend, the Bumblebee or something like that. What's
the Killer Bee?
Right. It's like Like, if you get one of your hands on one of those and you look at the cap and the amount of work that has been in there, and you're like, this is something special, right? Espinosa Comfortably Numb, right, is like, that is a special, special cigar in my opinion.
Right?
You know?
So, like I was, you know, said you were saying, we're talking earlier, there's all you can draw, that portfolio has sort of similarities that, that make them fit together. The relationships that we have in this business, you know, do the same thing. So, you know, I know that there are times when Espinosa's blender, so we'll go over, he works, you know, because we will do some business with AJ, you know, when they're in Nicaragua, he'll go over to you know, to Blackworks and do some stuff, Hector Bays. Elysion's working, you know, we do a little bit, you know, with Espinosa as well. You know, it's all intertwined, so it's kind of easy and interesting for me to see, because there's like a line that connects all of it. And it's funny because everyone's got a unique take on things, like, yes, you're saying, you know, Black Label, the Blackworks has kind of that unique artistry, you know, Espinosa. You know, I think our blending is on point right now. I think they're coming out with some of the most unique, you know, again, I give a lot of credit to Hector. We've said his name a lot, but this man has just, you know, I think blossomed into a monster when it comes to blending stuff together. I mean, everything that's coming out, if you haven't tried, you know, you said Comfort Numb, but, you know, the new Laranja Escuro, with the Matafino wrapper from Brazil, fantastic cigars. The Duce Provencia that's coming, fantastic. The Connecticut that he helped me work on, fantastic. You know, I mean, you hear me say it a lot, and I'm not trying to be, you know, overly positive about this stuff, but no, the cigars are coming out are great. Elysio, you know, same thing. It's just the blending that we're getting, you know, on top of the artistry that you're seeing is fantastic right now. Like I said, I don't see a single, you know, kind of thing that's missing. We're blending's great, construction's great. Yeah. You know, now you just got to go out there and try the cigars. I mean, Nicaragua is, I think you and I both know, making some of the best cigars in the world right now. And
yep,
I just happen to have five of the best companies in the portfolio. I can't say enough about how lucky I am about that.
Yeah, yeah. And every year, if we were to make a pie chart of regions of cigars, Nicaragua is getting a bigger piece of that market share year after year. And I've dubbed it here on the show as the Nicaraguan boom, where, you know, like, there's a lot of super cool blending that's done out of Nicaragua. And us cigar consumers, not only the Stogie Geeks, but the regular consumers as well, have, I mean, you vote with your dollars, right? So, mm-hmm, you know, they it's like they get more and more of a market share. And like Illusion and Espinosa and Black Label, they got some pretty sick blends for sure.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Drew, so, you're kind of quiet over there, buddy. Let's talk.
No, yeah, it was just interesting. And so, I mean, a lot of good stuff there, a lot of good information. For us, my Stogie Geeks crowd over here in Texas, Tim, one of the things that they found interesting was the bands, you know, the and the, you know, the colors, and then reading about how they came about. Could you
sure, yeah,
let our Stogie Geeks customers know about that?
Yeah, I've told the story a few times, and you know, I'm happy to kind of go through it again. When I like I was mentioning earlier, the cigar is sort of the easiest thing to get made, but putting branding together and being able to sell it, that, and giving yourself a brand identity, that was the hard part for me. So when I started the brand, looking for a name for the cigars, I actually went through the Spanish to English dictionary trying to find something cool and, like, you know. But what I discovered, yeah, was the names, you know, that were available to me that weren't trademarked already were either probably unpronounceable to non-Spanish speaking people, or just not, you know, not good. So I went back to the drawing board and said, okay, let me change the concept. Let me try and tell my story with the brand and the band. So I am a San Francisco kid, born and raised. That is home for me. Even though I live in Orange County, California now, that is, you know, home for me. My family's all still there. And so I started to try and figure out how can I incorporate, you know, that without making it a quote-unquote San Francisco cigar. So that's how Pier 28 came about. I have, you know, I have the Habano here, so I can walk you through some of the, I can't get this right. So some of the elements on it, you know, I don't know if any of you guys have ever been to San Francisco, but along the waterfront, there are 60 piers, and that's where the ships used to come in, whether it's crew, now they still do cruise ships, but they used to have a lot of, you know, commercial shipping, all that kind of stuff. And so living there, I actually lived six blocks from one that was numbered 28. The Bay Bridge actually goes over that particular pier. So there's a photo that was the inspiration for this particular brand. And if you look at the band, it has all those elements. The die cut, the shape of the band is actually the facade of the Pier 28 building. They all have unique architectures. If you look at the, also, there's I'm backwards here. So
yeah, right, right.
if you look at the chain link, the little lines there, that represents the span of the bridge. The little character, because I'm Chinese American, is my last name. So in my mom's eyes, I went from her kid that was a salesman to having this family cigar company. So that was
yeah.
We're superstitious people. So we're numerologists. The 28 is a lucky number. It means to prosper easily. I don't know if you guys have seen license plates with, Asian, Chinese specifically, it says Wong 888 or whatever. Eight means the number is synonymous with prosperity. So when you pair it with number two, it means to prosper easily. So you take all those elements together and it tells my story. And then the color scheme of the band. I try not to emphasize this too much because sometimes it gets me in trouble, but I've drawn from San Francisco and Bay Area sports teams. So that the Habano's got a blue and gold of the Warriors, the silver and black of the Maduro of the Raiders, of course. The third brand of Escola's got black and orange for the Giants. The Connecticut, which I have coming, it's September. This is going to use, I'm backwards, the San Jose Sharks colors, but you can see it's a kind of bad color, but it's white and teal. Mm-hmm. And then I have the Niners. I'm going to save that because, I grew up during their Super Bowl run. So I'm going to save that for something real special when I'm ready to do a limited edition. But that's kind of the theme that puts it all together. So everything, every element of the brand, whether it goes to the band or the brand name or everything, tells a little bit about my story and who I am.
That's awesome. And your rate is moving, right? I saw that stadium. Yeah.
I'm actually a Niners fan. The silver and black works for Maduro. So, I have a shop actually in Fremont, California. It's waiting for me to do the Oakland A's too. So
yeah.
The next blend, you'll see the green and yellow. Obviously, I'm trying to represent everybody. So
yeah, I stayed outside of the Mandalay Bay last week, and I saw the Radio Stadium being built. That thing is freaking...
You can't miss it from the side of the field.
You can see it from the plane. What's going to happen? Like, I don't know. You've obviously flown into Vegas. You've been IBCPI. Like, you're flying down. You got, 20 minutes in mountains. The captain puts on the sign, the ding-dong, right? The little belt. Everybody's sitting your thing. We're going to begin our descent. So you got about 23 minutes before you touch down, right? And you're flying 23 minutes. You keep going. 20 minutes is all mountains and nothing, right? And then all of a sudden, you can never get lost in Vegas because it's only one strip, and you know where you can go because you can see the building of where you're at. Where your destination is. You can see the Raiders. Here's the point of my story. If you're flying into Vegas, hold on. If you're flying into Vegas and you look to the right of Mandalay Bay, you see this freaking steel monster, right? Because all the walls are not. It's the freaking the stadium. It's humongous. It's going to be so cool. It's going traffic is going to be horrendous. But, hey, what are you going to do? It's a desert. You can just build a parking lot north and you keep going. You know what I mean? But it's just crazy to see how big. And then I did a little bit of research because I love advertising and marketing. FedEx dumped $90 million into that stadium. I don't know if it's going to be called the FedEx things and whatnot. But, it is going to be super cool. And then added on, so now you get to go see the Raiders. And it was funny because we hired a private driver this year as opposed to all of us taking Ubers because the whole team went for Security Weekly. So we had a private driver, and it was funny because he was talking about how, now people are going to be able to come to Vegas and see a great team and blah, 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 right? Now, we're Patriots fans out here, most of us, right? Yeah. So I get out of the driver, and I turn to Paul. I go, he was right about the economic development. The only thing he wasn't right about was a great team.
I don't want to piss off my friends. I have a lot of friends who are Raiders fans, but he's pulling out a playbook from 1991 and he admits it. So we'll see how he plays in that modern NFL.
And of course,
I don't think he's giving himself a chance with all the stuff with the Hard Knocks. And I was like, why you put yourself behind the eight ball? Get your team online, then go do that show, because who knows what comes out. And then, of course, he's got Antonio Brown doing the Antonio Brown thing. I mean, what new problem is going to come up with today? I mean, between the frozen, the frosty, the helmet, the $38,000 tab he walked out on. What else did you do? You had a long summer, brother, a long winter, whatever you want to call it.
A long off season, for sure.
Yeah, a long off season.
Yeah, for sure. So when take us through, the blending process. So you have to have some, when you create a business model, any business model, even if it's outside of cigar, you have something in your head, right? What was your goal when you produced your first cigar, second cigar, third, any order you want to talk? What was your goal for them to experience?
Sure.
Not only from a taste perspective, but from a experience perspective, like what made you come up with which stick first and second and stuff like that?
It's a little different for me. I mean, you basically have kind of two different groups of how how a cigar is made. Two different methods, right? If you are a brand owner like myself and you don't know a lot about tobacco, you know what you like. So basically you kind of put a concept together, and whichever factory you're coming out of, they actually will have blenders who will put together, try and come up with something that fits what you're looking for. Or you can, get your hands dirty. The guys like, Skip Martin, Dion from Elysium, all those guys will go down there and actually, do it themselves. I'm sort of in the middle of this. So, I know a little about tobacco, more than the average brand owner, but I'm also, not as deep as these guys. So I'll tell you the story about how the Habano specifically got put together. And hopefully, Hector Alfonso, our blender, is watching this because it really is a great story. when I went down to, Miami to kind of work with them for the first time, I had a concept in my mind. Obviously, that's where it starts. What do you want to accomplish with the cigar you're blending? And the first cigar is also, they say that the first cigar that you ever come up with, first concept, is everything you love in a cigar trying to get out in one blend.
Right.
So I find that to be true. So what I wanted was a medium-bodied cigar. Like, my everyday cigars at that point, my classic cigars are like the Elysion Epernay, the Espinosa La Naranja, Bayas Artes from Major Fernández, Herrera Esteli, that medium-bodied, complex, full-flavored cigar. That's what I really want. I wanted a cigar. Again, that it also, part of it came from the business sense, because, you have to consider that as well. So I wanted a cigar that, the full-bodied guys could come down to and the mild guys could come up to, something that gave everybody a little bit of something that they could smoke. And that way, maybe that gave me a shot to put that cigar, because you don't want to come out of the gate too mild or too strong, because you get pigeonholed, right? You come in the middle, you can dial down, you can dial up from there, and maybe build a portfolio of blends. So that's what I came to Hector with. I was like, can we have something that, and then the other thing was, I am a fan of a sweet cigar. I mean, I don't know if you guys like O'Hale, but especially with my cigars,
there's a
sweet note to everything. So I wanted to make sure that was emphasized as well. So that's what we started the process with. We went down and I said, there's office, we're smoking cigars. Things are added, things are being changed. We'll try this. And we probably went through 15, 20, different things. And as I finally, we came up with one which was, this is it. And he thought I was kind of cool with it because, after smoking 20 cigars, and I didn't just smoke the beginning and taste it. I tried to smoke it down as far as I could because I wanted to see how the cigars goes. He was like, you can't. And the next day, him and Eric kind of went back and smoked the final version. He was like, this really is something there. And, and as we continued to try a few more, it just hit on all notes. I mean, it has, four different tobaccos in it, four different countries. Six different tobaccos. It was designed to be sort of that perfect blend that hits at least a little bit of different note palette that I want to. Because you can't, do everything, but you want to give them a little bit of it if you can. So that was the concept. I'll tell you a little side story too as well. Hector has got his own little follower. He's got his personality online, and they call him Mr. Warm. And he can be a little grumpy sometimes if things are not going his way. And he was very patient with me, sat and smoked. And I even looked at him and said, a year later, how did you manage to be so patient with me going through this process? He goes, well, I got to tell you, you're the pickiest MF I've ever met. I wanted to punch you in the face a couple of times, but Eric Jr. wanted you as his rep. So he said, give the kid what he wants. So, but I really wasn't going to kill you at some point. So, and now we've gotten much better at it. Now it's a simple process. It's like, Hector, this is what I want. A couple of times I've actually been down in Nicaragua when he's left me stuff to smoke and try this, and we work. And it comes together very quickly because the good thing about Hector is he knows exactly what my palate is, and he can interpret my goals pretty quickly. And he puts things together, and that's, that makes things very, very simple. I trust him implicitly so that, there's no need to kind of go and be picky and choosy anymore, because once you get something down together, it's very quickly that blends comes together, for me at least.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's actually a cool story. How, you know, I'm sure it can get frustrating for sure.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and then also, like, when you're going through the taste test, like, the, you know, we've had various guests here on Stogie Geeks that say, you know, we only smoke it like halfway down and stuff like that. And, you know, they kind of, you know, they go through the blends, not quickly, but they go through them. You actually wanted to take the time out to see what each experience was. And that's a true testament. I smoke cigars every day, and you know, it's like I like to go through it because each cigar really is a journey. And then you can tell a good cigar by when you get really towards the end as well. You know, like if it still leaves you wanting, you know, more and have it there. So that's actually super cool. Drew, you
that's it.
Go ahead.
I can see Hector screaming at his computer right now because I'm with you. I have a personal philosophy where I try. I mean, that's all always happen. Most of the time is if you hand me a cigar, it could be any cigar. I don't care what that cigar is. I'm going to try and smoke it to the end. Yep. I want to see, you know, how it begins, how it ends, how it finishes. I mean, it tells me a story. But, you know, there are a lot of times where a cigar sometimes isn't good. And, you know, I'm hoping it gets better. It doesn't, right, necessarily, because it is what it is, and heck, you'll see. Why do you keep doing this? This cigar is not going to get better. You're crazy.
Yeah.
Smoke another cigar, you know?
Yeah, some stories are like movies, man. There's no survivors left.
No,
you know what I mean? Like, you know.
Right.
Now, interesting. And then, like, even when we were smoking test runs that first time, I would smoke about half and move on to the next one. And you guys, what are you doing? I'm going back. I want to smoke the rest of this. Are you crazy? You know? She just recently traveled with me. That one of the big kind of, you know, arguments we got into. It's like, why do you keep doing this? It's like, this car's not going to get better. I don't know. That's why I'm smoking it. I want to know if it gets better.
Yeah.
Does it? Mm.
So now Espinosa, other Espinosa reps are going to be able to have your cigar in their portfolio as well. Yes.
So it is actually part of the Eric and Susan again, very kind. It's part of the portfolio. It's in the catalog. It's in the price sheet. I have my own separate price sheet and stuff. Or I'm sorry, should say, but you know, he presented as part of the line, which is great. You know, the reps are, you know, pushing if they can. And you know, it for me, I take a different approach, right? I'm not in a position where I have to be a numbers driven company right now. It's a fun thing to do for me, and then eventually it may be, but I want people to find my cigars organically. So if a store goes, well, I don't know, I'm not ready for it. Okay. You know, I want that, you know, that brand to kind of exist. And it's starting to, you'll see it a little more on social media and people, for me, I firmly believe that if they find that cigar on their own somewhere, their connection is going to be stronger. I really like this. You know, I stumbled upon it in my humidor. So, you know, I have the ability and the time to kind of let it grow that way. And every year the numbers have been better. And you know, the Oscuro was probably the biggest hit that I had. Same thing. People were all over. I found this cigar. It's all over social media. They take a picture of it and I thank them for it. And that I believe that consumer for me is going to be that one that's going to be connected to that brand and to me, you know, longer because they were able to do that. So, you know, I'm willing to take a more patient and kind of a slow turn approach to distribution and getting the cigars into people's hands.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to it. There's a couple shops here in Rhode Island that really carry Espinosa.
Yeah.
They're the better of the shops, right? We have like 39 shops here in Rhode Island. It's a 45-minute drive through with no traffic. Mm-hmm. It's pretty highly concentrated area-wise. There's probably a 10-minute drive to each cigar shop, and you know, and the ones that carry the Espinosa, I'm looking forward. I'm gonna ask them if they're gonna consider that because that's the only way really we can get like access. I try not to buy online, personally.
We appreciate.
Yeah,
you know, obviously, you got to do what you got to do. You buy cigars where you can, but you know, it's sporting brick and mortar. You know, has always been you know, especially me being on the road, it's our priority. I know that, like I said. You know, online sales is part of our business. It's just the reality of it. But, you know, we need both sides. And sometimes brick and mortar gets thrown under the bus a little bit sometimes.
I think the brick and mortar who positions themselves can do very well online.
Yes.
They just, most of the owners really don't choose to go that route. And I think that they're really stopping more potential income and more, you know, because, you know, cigar enthusiast. Or cigar aficionados, however, or stogie geeks, or however you want to fill it in, they want to be loyal, right? Like I'm looking forward. I'm going to Florida in September, right? And I'm doing Stogie Geeks on September 13th. I'm not going to be in studio. No one's going to be in studio. Drew's going to be in Texas. I'm going to be in Florida. Mm-hmm. We're both going to be going to the studio. We're going to be interviewing someone else. That's going to be pretty rowdy, right? It gets weird when it gets weird when like everyone's on the road, because like people come up to me like in the shop and they're like, you know, because they say, oh, we're going to have Joe here from Story Geeks. And like, but here's the point of my conversation. I'm going to the shop that I did it last year on Los Alas Boulevard in Fort Lauderdale. That's where I'm doing it from. You know what I mean? Because, you know, he was the one who opened up his doors to me. Like, guys, like, come on in, you know. And then, like, I ended up doing Story Geeks and hanging out there all day. Next thing you know, my significant other comes in, and we're just hanging out there all day, getting to know. There's a shop owner, husband and wife. They're super cool. You know what I mean? And I was like, oh, yeah, I'm coming down again. He's like, that's great. It's going to be awesome. Like, you know, he knows I like the Miami Cuban music. So he actually gets, like, a guy playing. Like the piano and the sax, and does all of that stuff, and you know, it's just super cool. And here's my point: he's online, right? Maya Salva is a brand name, right? They're not very popular here in the Northeast at all, right? There's one shop that really has them, and they have them sporadically. I buy my Maya Salvas from the shop in Florida, and I scan the card, he ships them to me, and there you go. So you get loyal. So it's like, you never know, especially if you own a shop in one of those destination cities like California, like a Texas, you know, Rhode Island here in the Dallas, Texas, you know, it's like, it's crazy.
Yep.
No, your point is very valid, though. I mean, you know, dealing with retailers for as long as I have, I've tried, you know, I think they and I both realize that the biggest difference that they have between anybody else is themselves. Mm-hmm. And if, like you were saying, if you like the people that you've just done business with, you will support them in having, you know, their own webpage or having an 800 number to call. Yeah. Those guys will support you. You know, that's the difference, right? You can buy a cigar from anybody, but what makes people want to buy it from you? And that's what makes it great.
It's experience from when they come into the shop.
Exactly. You can actually have many methods of communication to do that. So it'd still be a brick and mortar at heart.
Yep, for sure. For sure. Drew, you have any questions for Tim?
Yeah, no, I was just going to let Tim know that I actually got my hand on one cigar, an Oscuro Robusto. And I'll tell you, some of the people around me were just like, what is that? I'm like, oh, it's something from California. They're like, what? So, well, I said the Tim Wong's from California, but it's the Brazilian Oscuro, Nicaraguan binder filler. I'll tell you, that's definitely going to go to my regular rotation. Very nice.
I'm glad you mentioned that. The Oscuro has actually been the strongest blend that we've done to date. The first question I always get on that particular cigar is, how do you call it Oscuro? Because if you pick up that cigar and you look at the wrapper, it isn't as dark as, say, a Maduro or an Oscuro Maduro cigar. But, you know, Oscuro just means dark in Spanish. So that particular wrapper is a variant of what Espinosa uses on L'Orange. It's the same Brazilian. But when you get a bale of tobacco in the, you know, in the factory, you have to grade it out because it's not sorted into a particular color. You know, so you want to make sure that the wrapper you're using is the correct shade. So everything that's sorted in the lighter tones goes on because he wants that really light, that orange color, that hue comes out. So he gets that, you know, that's where it goes on. And he's got some of this darker wrapper that sometimes doesn't, you know, make that particular cigar, but we want to use something for. So when I got down there to look at some of the samples they were doing, I fell in love with them. And the flavor is phenomenal. The color is beautiful. It's got that kind of Colorado reddish color. But it is the factory graded it as Oscuro. So that's why I call it. People ask me, it's not dark. It is for that wrapper. That's why we graded it in the factory. So that's why I call that particular the Oscuro for Pier 28. So but that blend was designed to hold up to that wrapper, you know, because I don't do a lot of sizes within. Each one of my blends has four sizes because I try and be as retail friendly as possible. I've had many conversations with retailers before I launched, and you know, some lines have 12, 15 sizes in a line. What I try to do is make variety between the line, you know, between the blends. Mm-hmm. So there are four blends, only 16 SKUs total. The only size that's consistent across the four blends is the Robusto 5x52. But yeah. My philosophy is always a small size. My cigar geek got size.
Yep.
Either a Corona Gorda, a regular Corona. We do a size called Rabito in Melazona, which is a 6.5 by 46 with a pigtail. Love that. Then there's always going to be some variant of a Toro. And then the last size is a fun size. You know, it's always like, so the Habano's got 6x60, that the Oscuro's got a Perfecto, which is, you know, the first shape cigar I've done, and that thing smokes fantastic. If you haven't smoked that size, I'd recommend smoking that or the Rubito in that line, because both those blends, both those sizes represent that blend well. So we try and do, I try and mix it up a little bit and try and keep it reasonable so that I don't take up too much shelf space, but I give myself a good representation of the four blends that I have.
That's awesome. Nice. Tim, in your travels the next couple of days, if you could email me. I know you had sent me when we first did your first interview where we can get Pier28 cigars.
Mm-hmm.
Email that to me now. Well, not now, but like after the interview or so, so that it's fresh, because the Stogie Geeks listeners are going to email me at joeh@stogiegeeks.com. And they're going to say, where can I get these? And I'm going to be like, I don't know. You know what I mean? So, yeah, I know you sent me a couple of retailers. Because it happens all the time. You talk about the cigar, and I want to chase after it. And if I can have it handy, I can forward it to them. That'd be awesome.
Absolutely. I'm more than happy to do that.
Cool. Because you don't have a website set up.
I do not.
I know, right? I was doing some extensive search for you.
It's embarrassing. You know, I've been trying to do it, but again, it's finding someone with the expertise to do it for me that's going to do it, for a reasonable price. If you guys, out there, willing to work for cigars and are a graphic, I'm a website artist.
There you go. If you are a graphic designer and you want some boxes of Pier28, email me at joeh@stogiegeeks.com. I will forward the email. Careful of what you ask for, because it could happen.
Here's one of the things. Being an on-the-road rep still, I try and be fair to the brands that I represent. Mm-hmm. So almost always I'll kind of push my, unless it's already in the store, I'll kind of push my brand last, because, it's sort of the thing that, I'm trying to be responsible to the guys that are, paying my bills. So I don't want to say it that way, but So that means that my own personal marketing sometimes is the last thing on my list of things to do. And the website, the one thing that we've been good at a little more is social media. That's more active. It's easier for me to kind of maintain and do on the fly versus, trying. But that's why, I will have a website. I promise at some point there will be one. But, it is a little poor marketing on my part, especially for a guy who has a marketing background. Yeah, absolutely correct.
It's kind of your space to tell your story. And I think that if you're doing well, you're not the first. Yeah. Company to certainly not have that, and I think that social media plays a big play in not creating that sense of urgency for you, right? But you at least got to book a name and do a URL forward to like Facebook.
I owned the domain. That part I got right.
So
what's embarrassing for me is before I got in the cigar business, I was a .com kid. I worked in Silicon Valley for 10 years during the first boom. When AOL and Yahoo were in their infancy. So
yep.
It is embarrassing for me to kind of go say, I haven't actually done my website.
No, you got to go pays the bills. Why do you think every time I'm on Stogie Geeks, I mention Security Weekly? Right, because it pays the bills.
Right,
you know what I mean. You gotta. That's how it works. So I get that. But at least from being in working with cybersecurity. See, here I go again. Right, but from at least have the URL that you host it in the name. Point somewhere where they can contact
somewhere
you.
With something on
the, have it point to your Facebook for now, and then there's it there because then people will start getting used to that. There, and then they obviously via Facebook they can find you, ping you, DM you, whatever the heck it's called.
Cool.
Now, what I want to say, right off the bat is this: I mean, if you love that full flavor cigar, so geek listeners, if you're out there, not if you're out there, you are out there. I definitely recommend a box purchase on that. I mean, that is to me. I love full flavor cigars. The sweetness, the spiciness, some of the creaminess I got from the almond, it just came out very, very nice in transition throughout the cigar.
And you heard me mention it. I try to make it retail friendly. I also try to make my cigars consumer friendly. And what I mean by that is everything is in a 10 count box. So if you want to buy a box, you're not committing to 25.
Yep.
The MSRP, I don't have a cigar that is more than $9.99 on the retail side before tax, of course.
Yep.
And again, that's because I've been in shops and I've talked to consumers. I mean, what's the magic price point for most people? Still $8 to $10.
Sure.
So, you know, I want to hit that sweet spot for that, you know, every checkbox I can hit to make my cigars something that you might want to consider, I try to hit that checkbox. You know?
Yeah. Yeah. Nice. That's a good move, too. You know what I mean? It's a good move. Because at the end of the day, it's about moving sticks.
Sure.
You know, it's yeah. moving sticks. And
as much as I love being a Stogie geek and being a boutique owner, and people ask me, what do you want to do in this business? I'm not going to lie. I work for Rocky Patel. I'd love to be Rocky Patel. You know, you want to sell 20, 30, 40 million cigars a year. You want to be, you know, loved around the country. You hear, there's a business aspect. It's like pro sports, right? You get to decide the passion, the things you love about the game. And then, of course, you still want to make your $300 million year contract. So those are the things you want to balance in life.
Hey, man, it's not bad being Tam either because I will tell you, I've emailed you more than Rocky Patel this year. I stayed on you. I was like, freaking, you're coming on Stogie again. I want to talk about Pier28. Joe, IPCPR is in 2 weeks. Joe, IPCPR is in 2 weeks. I'm busy. Well, we're all busy. Like, we're all busy. You know, how was the show for you?
Good morning. It's Friday morning, and when we're done, I'm ready for a cigar. So
nice.
Yeah, it's going to be perfect.
How was the show for you for IPCPR? Like, were you in the Espinosa booth? Were you there?
For me, it was a different experience. Like I said, this is the first time I was representing multiple brands.
Yep.
More than two, actually. I've worked for AJ and Brett Spinoza for a long time. So I had appointments from bell to bell. Mm-hmm. At some point, I was doubling and tripling up the appointments. So, you know, I was, I'm a big boy. I mean, so there was one day where my iPhone said I was doing 18,000 steps. I'm not built for that. So,
sure.
But all that means I had a great show.
Yeah.
You know, the brands that I had, you know, were moving definitely. I was interested in all of it. I saw what the other people saw. The attendance, you know, seems light, but it's been that way for years.
Right.
But from a positive standpoint, the people that are coming are actual buyers, and you actually have time to sit with them and smoke and kind of get the, you know, interface with them versus, you know, when the show is more crowded, I got another meeting in half an hour. Tell me what you got. You rush through it. You don't get time. Now, you know, guys have time to sit through the entire 45 minutes to an hour. You know, you can present the new stuff to them, you know, figure out what they need. You know, the time is actually valuable. So, you know, for me, like I said, personally, fantastic show.
Mm-hmm.
For other people, I understand if you hear them, you know, complaining about attendance and those kind of things. I get it. But I can't complain about how I did the show.
Yeah, I've received some mixed feedback from companies, and again, I take it from where they are positioned in the marketplace. And there, some of them had complained about the fledgling attendance.
Mm-hmm.
Some of them have also complained about where that show is starting to pivot. With
mm-hmm.
with the consumers and the consumer day and all of that stuff. We're going to save that for another episode.
That's
for
good.
Sure. You know what
that's
I mean?
Another hour discussion.
So if you want me to call you again, which means I'll really call you more than Rocky Patel. See?
Yeah.
Because I actually want to do a panel at some point here on Story
yeah.
Geeks and get some people to kind of yeah. weigh in. Some of them don't really have like the friggin' balls to weigh in. Like, oh, it's IPCPR and we need them. It's like, sure, I get it. It's a lightning strike event for your company, but what I think that's unique about you in the marketplace is when you release your cigars, like, you're not waiting for IPCPR. I'm talking about Tim in Pier 28. Mm-hmm. You're like, when it's ready, it's gonna get released and it's gonna be on a sheet. And if you want to enjoy and partake, let's do it.
IPCPR for me has become more of a platform just to announce the product. You're absolutely correct. You know, we're being a small factory. Sometimes, you know, I have to kind of go with what the flow is. You know, other stuff has priority and they program me when they can. So I just want to make sure it's out there and keep, you know, get enough samples to keep people interested. But, you know, it worked well for me in the for the Oscuro because last year when that cigar was announced, it was in the middle of all that kind of turmoil in Nicaragua.
Mm-hmm.
So the cigar didn't come out till end of November. You know, normally I try and get out July, August, you know, that time frame, September, right after the show. But because there was nothing new at that time, it just kind of people kind of hooked to it because of the fact that it was something new. And you know, we know how new stuff drives our industry. So it was fortuitous for me. I think the same thing is going to happen with the Connecticut. If looking at the September timeframe, you know, it'll be nice that there isn't a lot of static and a lot of other things coming out at the same time. So people have the chance. You know, my accounts will say, hey, I could be a Pier28 Connecticut team and I can hand it. And I'll get that stage for the 5 minutes, you know, without having them say, oh, this is new as well.
Yeah.
So that works out great for me.
Yeah, that makes sense. That makes sense. I will be emailing you to invite you back on the show at some point later on in the year, and definitely keep in touch. I want to thank you for your time. And it's great to get some inside knowledge as to how you created and how you started and where you're positioned and where you want to go. And if there's any product updates, just flash me an email. I'll keep the listeners.
I'll let you know when the Connecticut's hidden stores.
Yeah, that'd be awesome. That'd be awesome. Tim, I want to thank you for your time here on Stogie Geeks. Stogie Geeks listeners, stay tuned. Drew and I are going to go over some of the sticks of the week. We'll be right back.